morning. My name is Ron Centeno, C-E-N-T-E-N-O. I'm a parent of an eighth grader. I'm from Zapata, and I'm here on behalf of Zapata and my students. I mean, I'm here to react on this cut budget. It's gonna impact our students on their labor academy. And I also want to say, if you got federal funds, my community, Little Village, has been getting hit by the COVID. There's a lot of parents that lost jobs. Also, they've been closing a lot of stores, businesses, and we are ready to receive that impact. I mean, the federal funds. And to be honest, this is not fair to be cutting on the school budget. That relief, we actually need it. Instead of cutting, we need that relief to get a better education for our students. Thank you.
Yeah.
Woo!
Can you say it in Spanish?
Can you say it in Spanish?
Mi nombre es Román Centeno. Yo vengo representando a los estudiantes de Zapata y los padres. Vengo a protestar acerca de estos cortes que está haciendo el Board of Education. A nosotros, Zapata trabaja duro en tratar de mantener a todos los maestros. Si nos cortan los budgets, vamos a tener una más largo volumen de salón en nuestras escuelas. Nuestros estudiantes no pueden dar el nivel académico si no tienen la atención suficiente para superarse en el futuro. Tenemos un fondo federal que acaba de llegar. A Little Village fue impactado por el COVID. Muchas personas perdieron su trabajo. También muchas personas perdieron muchos seres queridos. Negocios han cerrado. La comunidad de Little Village está listo para recibir ayuda federal. No sé, la tiene, ¿por qué no la niegan? Gracias.
¡Woo! ¡Woo! ¡Bien dicho!
Next, we will hear from a teacher, Juan Sanchez, from Zapata Elementary.
Good morning, my name is Juan Sanchez, J-U-A-N-S-A-N-C-H-E-Z. I'm an educator at Zapata Academy. I speak here today not only as an educator from that school, but also as an LSC teacher representative, and also a parent from a student at Zapata. Our community is very proud of the high level of education that we provide for all of our students.
Yes,
today,
yes.
That high level of education is under threat. It's under threat by a CPS leadership that proposes to cut our budget by almost $900,000.
That's right.
That would drastically
criminal.
That's Zapata. This $900,000 cut would negatively impact our school. One, by raising class sizes and at the same time reducing services for our students that are most struggling, including our diverse learners, those who need additional social emotional support. I shouldn't need to remind everyone that this is happening during a global pandemic.
Right.
A pandemic that has disproportionately affected the Little Village community. In our school zip code alone, over 20,000 confirmed cases of COVID have happened since the beginning of the pandemic. The South Lawndale community of Little Village has one of the highest mortality rates per capita in all of the city of Chicago.
Criminal!
This is the reality. The reality is that this proposed budget is dangerous to our students. It's unethical to the taxpayers that it represents. And it ultimately is unnecessary.
Amen.
It is unnecessary because CPS is slated to receive over $2 billion in COVID relief funds.
Say it.
The majority of which has not reached classrooms.
That's right.
Unspent, as the Board of Education has even acknowledged. To be clear, this is a choice. This is a choice to undercut, to underfund, and to undermine schools like mine's ability to adequately educate our children. So today we speak directly to the mayor, to her chosen board, and we demand that they listen to the voice of the people.
Woo!
That they represent the people well, and that they respond in the best interest of the people. by rejecting this budget that undercuts, undermines, and underfunds our schools, and that they adequately fund all schools. Free the funds.
Hear, hear!
Sánchez, soy maestro de la escuela Zapata en la comunidad de La Villita. Estoy hoy aquí hablando no nomás como educador, pero también papá de un estudiante de la escuela Zapata. Estamos aquí protestando los recortes de fondos a nuestro presupuesto, que este año solo se quiere cortar más de $900,000 de nuestro presupuesto.
¡Criminales!
Esto va a impactar negativamente a nuestra comunidad, en aumentar el tamaño de clases de salón y al mismo tiempo reducir los recursos que están disponibles para los niños que los más necesitan, los niños que están en clases especiales y también los estudiantes que necesitan más apoyo en lo socioemocional. La comunidad de La Villita ha sido impactada negativamente desde el empiezo de la pandemia. Tiene uno de los niveles de muertes más altos en toda la ciudad. En el código postal de la escuela Zapata solamente han sido más de 20,000 casos confirmados. Esos son los más que son confirmados. Que ya sabemos que hay muchos más que no han sido confirmados. Uh-huh. Pero todo esto, estos recortes de fondos, no es necesario. Es una decisión que el distrito está haciendo, y todo durante una pandemia. No es justo, y estamos aquí para protestar esos cortes.
¡Bien dicho! ¡Justicia!
We have another speaker here, Paul Denobi. We want to ensure that folks understand that the $2 billion are there. It has been unused by this mayor. He's choosing not to fund our schools, not to prepare our educators for next year, and our students to receive the resources that they need. To hear more about that, we'll hear from Paul Denobi from Bridge Elementary.
Hello, my name is Paul Denobi. AULDENOVI. I am a teacher and union delegate at Bridge Elementary School on the northwest side. I've been a part of the school community since 2014. Our schools need investments, not cuts. We deserve to have healthy and safe school buildings. Our main building is around 100 years old, and our middle school campus is on lease from the Archdiocese of Chicago. We have two mobile buildings outside the main building for fourth grade, kindergarten, and pre-K. The main elementary building has asbestos and lead. Asbestos materials were found in 116 areas of the building, including 34,000 square feet of ceiling tiles, plaster drywall, containing friable asbestos, which can cause cancer. In 2016, lead was detected in water faucets, with the highest level of lead detected in the drinking fountains outside student bathrooms. No amount of lead is safe for children. Exposure to high levels of lead may cause kidney and brain damage.
That's right.
The gymnasium had major flood damage from heavy rain, and it has taken 3 years for CPS to finally get around to fully addressing the damage. The first phase of fixing this damage was asbestos abatement and lead paint mitigation.
Thank you.
Done while we were in the school building. When it's cold outside and the heat is turned on, half the building will get extremely warm. When it gets warm, we have noisy AC units, which makes it very hard for students to learn. Our students deserve modern buildings for the 21st century. There are many things that can be done to fix our schools right now that would be extremely helpful. CPS claims they have a climate action plan, but a real climate action plan wouldn't just source renewable energy. It would renovate our school buildings to accommodate overcrowding, prepare for climate change, and create an environment that is healthy, comfortable, safe, and free of lead and asbestos.
That's right!
Fully funded green public schools,
yes,
for our,
yes,
communities.
All schools!
Now!
Woo!
They were on the front line during the pandemic, and they've also been on call for providing services to parents, to students, to the community, and to the school. And for CPS to present to them that they're going to privatize their positions is another upset. We went through this before with CPS. When they tried to privatize our school clerks, we pushed back and we won. We even had this issue to happen with some of our pre-Head Start students and staff members. So we're saying to CPS, enough is enough. You failed with privatization in the city of Chicago. We're telling you that we're not going to stand for that. These people deserve to have a job. They were essential workers for you
during
the pandemic. And they deserve to have a job to go to every day. And we're asking you, telling you, that we expect those positions to be budgeted by CPS and that there be a tech coordinator placed in every single school in the city of Chicago. Technology is a must. Their positions are necessary. The parents count on them, the students count on them, and the school count on them.
Hear, hear.
Enough is enough.
Hear, hear. Right. Preach.
When education is under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back.
Next, we will hear from our president of the Chicago Teachers Union, Jesse Sharkey.
On behalf of the 25,000 members of the Chicago Teachers Union, but also the 500,000 or more parents and students that go to the Chicago Public Schools, I call on the mayor and the leadership of this board to reverse the harmful school cuts.
Now!
In the context of billions of dollars of federal funding to help students during the deadly pandemic, now is not the time to be punishing local schools.
That's right!
Now is not the time to be cutting special educators.
Yes,
sir. Now is not the time to be laying off technology coordinators. Now is not the time to be cutting art, cutting other vital programs in our schools. Now is the time to use the federal funds for what those federal funds were intended for. To support our schools and support our students during the recovery from this pandemic.
Hear,
that
hear.
Is what we must do. Anything less is a travesty. Anything out less is a failure of the public faith. They must reverse the cuts. Reverse the cuts now. Thank you.
Reverse the cuts.
Woo!
These racist cuts!
Right. So I want to come back to the special education cuts that Jesse alluded to. This year we had 450 students in a virtual academy. The majority of those students are students who have IEPs, who are not being properly serviced in the event that they come back into the school. They're not including the necessary supports that are going to be needed, the additional supports
Criminal.
That are going to be needed to matriculate them back into the school learning environment. Schools are able to appeal these budget cuts, but by the time that happens, educators have been laid off. They then go to other districts to find employment. They do not feel valued and cared for in the system in the midst of a pandemic while trying to educate our students so passionately. CPS must keep the current number of special education teachers and teacher assistants in schools where the district cut positions for the upcoming school year.
Right.
This staffing is necessary to prepare schools for the COVID recovery support in the upcoming year. This will also help school staff to make IEP decisions based purely on the students' needs, not forced to make decisions on vacancies. At this point, we are waiting on one more speaker. We'll take questions and also some opening remarks from Stacey Davis Gates, our Vice President of Chicago Teachers Union.
Stacey, can I ask a question as a mom?
Just a second. I want to cede some time to our sister union, SEAU 73. We are in school buildings with them. When we talk about special education cuts, they have a stake in this as well because we work hand in glove with their members in our school community. Stacia.
Thank you, Stacey. My name is Stacia Scott, S-T-A-C-I-A, S-C-O-T-T, the Executive Vice President for SEAU 73. As Stacey said, a number of our special education classroom assistants are on the chopping block this year for layoffs. It is hard to imagine how, after what this year has been for our students, that we would be cutting staff from our students.
That's right.
Yes.
I have met with security officers who have created safety plans more than they could have ever thought possible before because of the rate at which students have tried to self-harm in our buildings. We need more support for mental health in our schools.
Yes.
We need more special education classroom assistants. able to do one-on-one. This is important because it's legally required in many of our students' IEPs, and yet when they cut in the district level, it means that our CECAs move to being shared when they should be dedicated. The students deserve
that's
to
right.
have someone that works directly with them. We should not be cutting corners and cutting costs. This is a recovery year. I was out at Gregory last week. And Gregory is in North Lawndale, facing upwards of $400,000 in cuts. The students were walking out happy, high-fiving their staff, so excited to be back
I got the whole thing.
And learning.
Oh, good.
And it was like walking through a ghost town because the inevitable is going to happen. Those cuts will eventually lead to less parents sending their children to that school, and it will put them into a death spiral, which will lead to more and more and more cuts.
That's right.
This board has an opportunity right now to offer CPS a recovery year. $60 million is a rounding error in this budget. Not to mention they have $1.9 billion that they could be investing in our students.
Yes. That's yes. right, they should have invested.
They have all of this money to cover the $60 million. Give our schools the opportunity to bounce back, to have the supports necessary in the building, to give the children the opportunity not just to go to school, but to thrive. So I say that to say we need more CPAs in the schools, not less.
That's right.
Yeah.
More
custodians in our buildings, not less.
That's right.
We need our tech folks to stay in-house, not be outsourced and privatized. We know the history of privatization of CPS. We need this investment from the board, and we will work together to figure it out to boost enrollment, right? But for right now, do not make these cuts. Thank you.
Never!
Very clear about the next thing. that there is money. The federal government sent to the Chicago Public Schools money for recovery. Money for recovery. We have not recovered, so we need
We're
that
We're in a
money.
Pandemic.
That's right. That's right.
Still in a pandemic.
That's right.
We have a mayor, we have a board of education, and we have a CEO who have pledged to be good stewards of
Whoa.
Our school district.
Failure.
We're going to need that to happen. We're going to need that to happen. I'll take questions.
I have a question from the People's Tribune, and I'm also a mom of two CPS students. So on top of the federal money, there were like, what, $4 billion in COVID funds. How has that money been spent?
Well, the money is missing from the classrooms we need it for so desperately. And so that is a great question to be directed towards our mayor, her CEO, and her Board of Education. We are saying that we need more, not less.
That's right.
You see, this is a prelude to closing schools.
We have a moratorium on school closings right now. So whatever prelude they have, we are gracious that the Illinois General Assembly has saw fit to give us some confidence in the stabilization of our school communities, at least in this time period.
One more question from the People's Tribune. It seems to me that based on the budget cuts, they are cutting the budgets of poor black and brown students the most. Can you speak to the racism that you perhaps see in these budget cuts?
Perhaps. Look, white supremacy and patriarchy is endemic to the fabric of our country, not because we want it to be, but because it is. That being said, the work that we do with our families, 90% of the students who attend the Chicago Public Schools identify as Latinx or Black. We have to provide needs, their needs, right? And that has been an ongoing struggle for quite some time. One that our families stand up to, one that our community coalition stand up to all the time. Our union, as well as SEIU 73, are proud to stand in coalition and work with the people who need it the most. We have to prioritize their voices. We have to prioritize their needs. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Congrats. Sorry.